Baraka.
Yes.
Thanks. I mean, you know, personally, thank you so much for doing this. And thank you for all the support you've given me through New Jersey PAC.
My joy.
All the support you've given me for all the works that I've brought into the company, even works including Mr. Battle in yes. Love Stories.
Yes.
For some of the works that you're going to see on the weekend. How you doing? Good. And it's just thank you for believing in the process.
Yes.
And believing in what I do, you yes. know, and supporting me that way. It's really appreciated. I'd also like to thank there's another your sister out there.
Our sister is out
Stephanie
there.
Stephanie Hewley, who yes. is right there.
And if you don't mind my saying so, next to Stephanie Hewley is our president, Larry Goldman.
Yes.
Thank you, Larry. Because what I do would not be possible without both of them. I have some questions for you. When you first joined Ailey, you didn't simply become another dancer. You didn't simply become a principal dancer. It's considered that you were Alvin Ailey's muse. In what way did he shape or reshape your own image of yourself as a dancer and what you thought your body could or could not do?
He reshaped the image that I had of myself because I had been trained in several types of dance, but basically ballet. You know, when I was 10 years old, I was studying with Anthony Tudor. And I was a child protege, and I'd had my first modern classes, actually my first Horton technique classes, when I was 19, you know. But other than that, I had studied Dunham and mostly ballet, and of course tap. Thank God I did that because of sophisticated ladies with the late great Gregory Hines, and a little acrobatics and some jazz. But basically, it was ballet. So, you know. I was used to terminology, you know, like a glissade, assemblé, plié, échappé. And when someone said, and a one, two. Or they didn't count at all, said you have to phrase this, you know. I mean, that was my, through not just Alvin, but through the great Tally Beattie yes. or Donald McHale, all these wonderful icons of American dance. Ulysses Dub. He wasn't there yet, but Ulysses. But he certainly changed the way we watch dance and the way we feel, you know, about how we move. And Alvin had a world view. I mean, the beginning of the company was celebrating the African-American cultural expression and experience in the modern dance tradition of our country. That's the way it started. It still remains. That is the underpinning of our company. In that comes its universality, because we know who we are, so we have to know who everybody else is too, and everybody else becomes us. We are all human. So there is the love of movement, there is the artistic spirit, and of course he was a genius, and the love, it's the love of people. That's what I remember most about Mr. Ailey. He loved people, period. He wanted to express what it was to be human on stage, not just how many pirouettes you can do and how high you can raise your leg, except you got to do all that stuff. But he really was interested in you being uniquely yourself, understanding that, not with your feet still on the ground, you know, with some humility, you know, but understanding that you have a truth, and the truth can be expressed through this extraordinary movement vocabulary that he gave us, you know. What was the first part of that question? No, there's another part to it. You said, how did Alvin change me that way? And then there was another part to it.
How Alvin shaped your image of yourself right. as a dancer and what you thought your body could or could not do.
I always thought my body could do everything. And I was wondering why everybody else was so short.
Well.
Okay. It was that if he said, if the teacher, whoever it was, Marion Suger was my teacher in Philadelphia from Judah Mar School of Dance. And I mean, if you can imagine, if I'm going like this with my arm and everybody else is like stretching to get their arm as long as mine, and then I do that, and I'm further than you're ever going to get. So the image, I always had the image in my mind from my marvelous teacher, Marion Suger, and also the great Dolores Brown. They're just wonderful mentors and teachers I had as a kid that was growing long leg and gangly. Mom and dad, you know. Mom and dad knew that I was going to be this long-legged, gangly child, and they wanted some grace coming out of me. So there I was in dance school when I was six, but my mother would never sit the way I'm sitting right now. My mother would be absolutely 10 inches longer this way, you know, ruler in the back, you know, the whole thing, a queen. And my father was the king, you know, and that was that. And the way they carried themselves demonstrated to me how I could be inside this body. I mean, we didn't analyze it back then. You just looked and you could see. You had constant examples of this ideal way of carrying yourself through the world. So being tall, I loved it because I could stand at the back of a line in elementary school and see it all the way to the front. I also had very long arms, so I could put sparks on a dodgeball. You know, I could. I really could. And I loved, you know, the things you do when you're in school. You do little races in school and, you know, playing games. And, you know, and I loved school. I loved learning. There were some subjects that I really loved, you know. Being in this body, I didn't know what it was like to be in anybody else's body. I knew this was good to me. You know, and I was still this, I still had my awkward moments, you know. I mean, I grew up in, you know, the 50s. I was born in 1943, so I grew up in the 50s where, you know, people wearing the poodle skirts, you know, those felt skirts with the poodles on them and the cinch waist belt. I didn't have a waist. I went straight up and down. What was called my waist was way up here someplace. I had real skinny little legs. So these little black strings coming out of it. And then feet, you know, my feet were a good size, I must say. But, you know, anklets on little tiny skinny legs, it was not comfortable. But once I got in my leotard and tights, I was, well, forget about it, you know. I mean, it was wonderful. It was a great release. I was also learning violin and piano. My father taught me how to play the piano. The school was giving instruments to you, so that I learned how to play the violin from school. And but there was this, about being inside of me was wonderful, you know?
So you were always comfortable in your own
Extremely.
Body. Extremely. No one had to teach you that, except maybe your parents.
Yeah, parents, teachers, but it wasn't even a matter of them saying, look, be proud in your body, da, da, da. No, just look around yourself, you know? And then my brother and I integrated a lot of schools that we went to, you know, so we were looking to each other. You know,
I knew we were sisters in another life, because I was the same. I mean, same thing.
Yes.
You know, my mother's carriage, how she carried herself. You know, my brother and I were the only two African American children all the way through seventh grade. You know, you had to fight a lot going to school. You know, you had to brush a lot of stuff off those shoulders. But yeah, it sounds very familiar.
Yeah, but you know, when you know that you know that you know, it's a wonderful thing, you know.
Yes.
It really is.
Oh, yes.
And I also grew up in the church, you know. I grew up in Mother Beth AME Church,
yeah.
You know, so
yeah.
You had all of that to
yeah.
come behind you
yeah.
on top of everything else, you know. So I had that, and I grew up in Philadelphia. I had the Philadelphia Art Museum, you know, and all the wonderful things there. So there's a lot of rich background that I had growing up as a child, and it just kind of fed into my life.
Yeah, I felt like on those Sundays, for me it was Brown Chapel AME Church. On Sundays, that was my sanctuary. Yeah.
Well, you know, what's interesting is that the other day, and I know you have to get through all your questions.
That's okay.
The other day, I took Mr. Battle with me. We went to see Fences, by the way. Oh. Anyway, we went to see that. But then the next 2 days later, I took him to Abyssinian Baptist Church because I had called ahead. One of our BFA students, who is Reverend Ebony Marshall, she was a BFA student, Fordham BFA program that we have, Fordham Ailey BFA. And she was a student for about 2 years in the BFA program, but she found her calling, and she is now a minister. We're hoping Reverend Dr. Ebony Marshall now, because she was defending her thesis on Wednesday. Lots of prayers going on there. But I called her ahead of time and said, I'm bringing the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater artistic director designate to this service, and I would like him to meet Reverend Dr. Butts. So, I mean, it was extraordinary to be introduced to that congregation that Sunday. We were standing in the need of prayer at that time because so many people had passed that week. So the whole congregation was holding hands and we were praying. I mean, this is such a tradition we have, you know. Everybody was holding hands and we were praying. And then the next thing I knew, we were sitting down, the pastor was making announcements, and then all of a sudden, Judith Jamison, we all know Judith Jamison, people, whole congregation applauds and everything. And then the next thing I knew, he was reading his bio, you know? And they were, the congregation was, you know, this way we are, warm and accepting, you know, and open. And it was a wonderful experience, wasn't it? And then I believe somebody stopped you on the street today and said, I know who you are. Yeah, uh-huh. That's gonna happen a lot, right? I'm done.
Please, would we all stand and give a round of applause for Judith Jamison.